Hi everyone, and welcome to my presentation. Thank you for attending this. So today I'm going to present some work which is entitled Algebraic Homotopy Interleaving Distance, and which basically aims at defining an interleaving distance at the level of the homotopy category of persistence module in order to less or equal than y. One yn, if and only if each coordinate or less or equal. Okay. And then.
Excuse. J'ai pas eu de souci. Mais en tout cas, c'est censé sortir mon nom qui s'est éteint.
Tout de suite, être moins bien. Sans.
Then I will define a persistence module, present some work which is entitled Algebraic Homotopy Interleaving Distance, and which basically aims at defining an interleaving distance at the level of the homotopy category of persistence module in order to get some stability results, in order to, at the end, obtain like a stable invariant for multi-parameter persistence module. So I will start with a quick recap on multi-parameter persistence. Then I will explain graded Petit numbers, which are a certain kind of invariant for multi-parameter persistence module. And I will also explain why they are not stable naively with respect to the interleaving distance. And then defining the homotopy interleaving distance, we will see that actually the stability is hidden at the level of resolution, free resolution of persistence module, from which are deduced the graded Petit numbers. So first, a persistence module over Rn. So we fix a field K, okay, and so we see Rn as a poset, okay, so ordered with the product order. So it means that x1 xn is less or equal than y1 yn if and only if each coordinate are less or equal, okay. And then I will define a persistence module just to be a functor from the poset category Rn to the category of K vector spaces. Okay, and I will use this notation to denote the category of persistence module over Rn. Okay, so basically it means that on each point of Rn, I put a vector space, and for each relation in the poset, I just put a linear map such that all of the squares commute. So the main example of persistence module arise from the application where basically I have, let's say, an input space, so data space that is called X, and I have a measurement H, a function from X to Rn, and I just want to study the sub-level sets of H. Okay, so given a value in Rn, I look at the pre-image of the set of X which are less or equal than S by H, okay, and then I define the ith sublevel set persistence module of H just to be the ith singular homology with coefficients in K of this system of topological spaces, okay. So now what is nice with persistence module is that we can put a distance which is meaningful for application in a certain sense, which is called the interleaving distance. So I'm not discussing why we choose this distance in this setting, but I mean, for a lot of reasons, this is a very meaningful distance, okay? And so basically, so this was introduced by Chazal in the one parameter case in Chazal and co-authors in 2009, and then by Lesnik in his PhD in 2011. So now given two persistence modules, so first let me introduce some notation. I can look at the shift of n by epsilon, for instance, where epsilon is a positive real value, okay? And so the shift is really just, I just shift the index I just shift the grading of my persistence module by epsilon, okay? Then once I have defined this shift, I always have a canonical map from m to its shifted version, okay, which I call the epsilon smoothing morphism. And now, so we can define the notion of epsilon interleaving, okay, between two persistence modules. And so an epsilon interleaving basically will be the data of two morphisms, f from m to n shifted by epsilon, and g between n to m shifted by epsilon, such that they commute, but up to the two epsilon smoothing morphism, okay? So this generalizes the notion of isomorphism, okay? Since, for instance, it is easy to check that zero interleaving are nothing but isomorphisms, okay? And so now we define the interleaving distance as just the infimum of the epsilon between M and N, such that M and M are epsilon interleaved. So now, why do we, what do we call like the curse of multi-parameter persistence? So in the one-parameter case, you might have heard of the so-called barcodes, which are complete discrete descriptors of one-parameter persistence module. So basically, you can describe entirely a one-parameter persistence module just with a list of intervals, okay, which is called the barcode. So thanks to some work by Carlson and Zormorodion of 2009, this is absolutely unreachable, and it is proved to be impossible to have such a description of multi-parameter persistence module, so when you have more than one parameter. So now, these algebraic structures are still very important for applications, for instance, in density-based clustering. And so in order to study those modules for data analysis, we cannot hope for some complete descriptor. So now we have to look for some partial descriptors of those modules. And so to be useful in practice, those descriptors should be so computable, okay, and stable with respect to the interleaving distance, meaning that you want that basically, if you move a bit, if you have some noise in your data, then you do not want the descriptor to move too far from the ground truth. Okay. So now let me describe the graded Betti numbers of a persistence module. So here I will really give a ND definition, not a really a proper mathematical one because it would be too long. But basically, so given n parameter persistence module, the graded Betti functions of M, so they are a collection of functions, okay, indexed by the integers. And so these are functions that goes from Rn to Z, okay, and such that the value of beta I of M at a point S, so for instance, if I is zero, then beta I of M of S is just but the number of minimal generator that appears at the grading S for M, okay. Then if I take I to be one, then it is the minimal number of relations between generators that appears at the grade S, okay. And then for I equal two, it is the relations on relations, and then etc. Okay. And so for a lot of reasons, so those invariants are like very interesting. This is some really well-studied things from algebraic commutative algebra, sorry. And now, under some finiteness, some perfectly standard finiteness assumptions on M, we can actually compute those descriptors. Okay, so we have the first item that we want for descriptors. These are computable descriptors of a persistence module. So now one question is, what about their stability? Okay, so to do so, I will go slightly more in depth in the definition. So let me define just what is a free persistence module. So a free persistence module is just a persistence module that is supported on an upper quadrant, okay, of Rn, and where in this upper quadrant, you only have the vector space K, which is linked by the identities map. Okay, so this is like the case of the minimal case in some sense of a free persistence module. And then a finite free persistence module will just be a finite direct sum of finite direct sum of those guys. Okay, and so for instance, so if in particular if M is finite free, then there exists a unique function that tells you at a given grade how many copies of FA appears. Okay, so when I have a finite free persistence module, I automatically have this function xi. Okay, and so now given a persistence module M, a free resolution of M is just a data of a chain complex here, okay, of persistence module, which is exact except in degree zero. And you want that in degree zero, this chain complex has cohomology isomorphic to M. Okay, And so some really standard result in algebra tells you that this always exists. Okay. And so now there is a notion of minimal free resolution, where in some sense you ask that at each step of the resolution, you have a minimal amount of direct sum of a free persistence module. Okay, so here, for instance, you would like that this function xi is minimal, okay, in some sense. And here, so now in this context, it is not always assured to exist, but sometimes it exists. Okay, and so if m admits a minimal resolution, then you have a nice way to compute the graded Betti numbers of m, which are just given by this xi function. Okay, so remember that the xi function for a finite free persistence module just gives you the number of summons that starts at a given grade A. Okay, so now let me describe an example that shows why the graded Betti numbers are not stable with respect to the interleaving distance. So now I define the persistence module n epsilon, which is just the persistence module with two parameters, which is supported on the squared zero epsilon. Okay, and so here you have depicted n epsilon. Okay, and those so the lower boundary is included, but the upper boundary is not. Okay, and now it is possible to show that so n epsilon is admits a finite free minimal resolution. Okay. And this is given by this chain complex. Okay, so this means that from this chain complex, you can read directly the Betti numbers of n epsilon. Okay, so it, here we can see that so in degree zero, we only have one summon. Okay, so it means that the Betti zero function is just one here and zero everywhere. Here we see that we have two summons in degree one, which is one here and zero elsewhere. And here in degree two, we see that we have just one here and zero everywhere. Okay. So now it's not hard to see that n epsilon is at interleaving distance epsilon over two of the zero persistence module. Okay. So this is depicted what I wrote here. And also you see that the zero Betti function of n epsilon does not depend on epsilon. Okay. And it is always the indicator of zero. Okay, so it is always the function that is worth one at zero, zero. Right, so in particular, this shows that when epsilon goes to zero, the interleaving distance from zero to n epsilon goes to zero, but the absolute value, the sup norm between the beta zero graded function stays constant. And actually the difference between those two functions stays constant. Okay. So this shows in some sense that the Betti numbers are very unstable because I can perturb with a different epsilon as small as I want. And I can change the Betti numbers by an arbitrary small perturbation. Okay. So now I will explain how, by looking at interleaving distance at the level of the resolution, okay, the free resolution, so in the homotopy category, we can actually explain this phenomenon. Okay. So now, first, one question, now that we have defined like free resolution, is I will just do a quick recap of homological algebra. So how can we lift morphism to free resolution? Okay, so there is a nice proposition that just says that when you have two persistence module and two free resolution of them, then given one morphism, you can always find at least one lift of this morphism such that every square commutes. Okay. Now there is the question of the unicity of a lift. Okay. And this is where the homotopy comes into action. Basically, so now you can ask yourself, so okay, now I take two different lifts of the same morphism, what can I say about them? Okay, and now what we can say is that actually their difference differs only from one thing that is called a null homotopic map. Okay, so it means that it is given by a collection of functions of degree minus one, okay, like this. And then you take, in some sense, the bracket with the differentials. Okay, so whenever I have two lifts of the same map, it is always it can always be written okay in this form. There always exists a collection of chain homotopies okay from F to G. And so in this situation, okay, when we have two maps F and G such that their difference have this form, we will say that they are homotopic. So now we can define a categorical construction which is called the homotopy category. Okay, so the homotopy category of the category of Pearson's module. Okay, so here for instance, A will stand for the category of Pearson's module. So it's the category which has object the chain complexes. Okay, so it's the category K of A. And then now to define the morphisms between two chain complex of Pearson's module, I will look at the chain maps, okay, between those complexes, but I will mod it out by the relationship of being homotopic. Okay. And so now this is like a standard result also that this gives rise to a well-defined category. And now the main advantage of this construction is that now taking resolution becomes a functorial construction, okay? Because you see that you can lift a morphism between two Pearson's modules at the level of their resolution only up to homotopy. So if I mod out the homotopy, then I indeed get something that is functorial, right? And so now what we do is that we define the homotopy interleaving distance between two chain complex of persistence module, well, in the same way as the interleaving distance. So here we define just the notion of being epsilon homotopically epsilon interleaved. So this is the same diagram, okay? But here I just ask that it commutes, but up to homotopy, okay? So it commutes when I mod out by the relationship being homotopic in the homotopy category. So now it allows to define the homotopy interleaving distance between two complexes as the infimum of epsilon such that X and Y are homotopically interleaved. Okay, and so this is an easy result to show that this is indeed an extended pseudo distance on the class of object of the homotopy category of Pearson's module. So now here is the main result of the paper. Okay, so in the paper, I showed that basically when you look at a resolution functor of a Pearson's module, then it is always isometric. Okay, so it preserves. So we have that given M and M two Pearson's module. Okay. It is equivalent to ask that M and M are epsilon interleaved, or to ask that any two. So this is a complicated notation, just to say that this is one free resolution of M and one free resolution of N. Okay. So this is equivalent that M and M are epsilon interleaved, or that any of their free resolution are homotopically epsilon interleaved. Okay. So in particular, it means that now we can do the operation of taking resolution while keeping track of stability. So now let's go back to our example with M epsilon. Okay. So remember that this C epsilon here was the minimal free resolution of N epsilon. Okay. And so epsilon was N epsilon was epsilon over two interleaved over with zero, okay, and so there is a nice characterization of being interleaved with zero in terms just of the smoothing map being zero, okay. And here we see that looking at this complex, it is very easy to see that this complex, the epsilon smoothing map is not zero, but is homotopic to zero. Just from eta epsilon. Okay, so this in particular explains the result that we show that the Betti numbers moves, but basically when you take into account all of the resolution, then with the homotopies, you can actually get interleaved with zero. So now the why this is interesting. So this asks so the question of so which homological invariant is now homotopically stable. Okay, so this shows that this is basically the level at which we should seek for invariant. And also there is some recent work by Lesnik and Bierkevich on Wasserscheing distances, which uses like Betti numbers and a minimal presentation to define a distance. And so this is like, I think, an interesting question to understand the links between their work and this result. And I thank you for your attention. And if you have questions, please don't hesitate.